provoke themselves to the confusion of their own faces? Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, mine anger and my fury shall be poured out upon this place, upon man and upon beast, and upon the trees of the field, and upon the fruit of the ground,
and it shall burn.
All these words unto them, but they will not hearken to thee. Thou shalt also call unto them, but they will not answer thee. But thou shalt say unto them, this is a nation that obeyeth not the voice of the Lord their God, nor receiveth correction. Truth is perished, and is cut off from their mouth.
Cut off thine hair, O Jerusalem, and cast it away, and take up a lamentation on high places. For the Lord hath rejected and forsaken the generation of his wrath.
For the children of Judah have done evil in my sight, saith the Lord. They have set their abominations in the house which is called by my name to pollute it. And they have built the high places of Tophet, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to burn their sons and their daughters in the fire, which I commanded them not, neither came it into my heart. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that it shall no more be called Tophet, nor the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter. For they shall bury in Tophet till there be no place. And the carcasses of this people shall be meat for the fowls of the heaven and for the beasts of the earth, and none shall fray them away. Then will I cause to cease from the cities of Judah and from the streets of Jerusalem the voice of mirth, and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, for the land shall be desolate. Chapter 8. At that time, saith the Lord, they shall bring out the bones of the kings of Judah, and the bones of his princes, and the bones of the priests, and the bones of the prophets, and the bones of the inhabitants of Jerusalem out of their graves. And they shall spread them before the sun, and the moon, and all the host of heaven whom they have loved, and whom they have served, and after whom they have walked, and whom they have sought, and whom they have worshipped. They shall not be gathered, nor be buried. They shall be for dung upon the face of the earth. And death shall be chosen rather than life by all the residue of them that remain of this evil family, which remain in all the places whither I have driven them, saith the Lord of hosts. Moreover, thou shalt say unto them, thus saith the Lord, shall they fall and not arise? Shall he turn away and not return? Why then is this people of Jerusalem slidden back by a perpetual backsliding? They hold fast deceit, they refuse to return. I hearkened and heard, but they spake not aright. No man repented him of his wickedness, saying, what have I done? Every one turned to his course, as the horse rusheth into the battle. Yea, the stork in heaven knoweth her appointed times. And the turtle, and the crane, and the swallow observe the time of their coming. But my people know not the judgment of the Lord. How do ye say, we are wise, and the law of the Lord is with us? Lo, certainly, in vain made he it. The pen of the scribes is in vain. The wise men are ashamed, they are dismayed and taken. Lo, they have rejected the word of the Lord. And what wisdom is in them? Therefore will I give their wives unto others, and their fields to them that shall inherit them. For every one, from the least even unto the greatest, is given to covetousness. From the prophet even unto the priest, every one dealeth falsely. For they have healed the hurt of the daughter of my people slightly, saying, Peace, peace, when there is no peace. Were they ashamed when they had committed abomination? Nay, they were not at all ashamed, neither could they blush. Therefore shall they fall among them that fall. In the time of their visitation they shall be cast down, saith the Lord. I will surely consume them, saith the Lord. There shall be no grapes on the vine, nor figs on the fig tree, and the leaf.
Sunday school. All the lucky ones get to stay here with me. Look at Matthew 24. Well, that's more or less what I'm going to be talking about. A day. There's going to be a day, and it's going to be a day of rejoicing, and it's going to be a day of glory, and it's going to be a day of vengeance, and it's going to be a day of wrath. And you know, the Bible, all the way through it, is constantly anticipating the end of the world. Look at Matthew 24. If you look at verse, I'm just going to start reading at verse 1. Because Brent will get on me for not reading the context. Anyway, it says, "And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, See ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?" Now, they were very impressed with the temple that Herod had built. God was not nearly as impressed with that temple, even though it was the eighth wonder of the world at the time. Tremendous edifice. They had increased the size of the mountain. They had built huge foundational blocks. Some of them were brought from somewhere there in the Middle East. They brought special sparkling marble, and they had built it up. It was a tremendous thing. Herod thought of it as his legacy. And it's an interesting, the whole story is interesting. But the disciples went over there, and they were really pointing this out to Jesus. Look at this temple. Isn't this just amazing? And Jesus said, not one stone's going to be left on another. It's not that impressive. God's not impressed with your wonders of the world. What God was telling you is there's something else you ought to be paying attention to. And so then they realize, okay, so if all this is going to be knocked down, they're assuming this must be the end of the world. And it wasn't. It was the year 70 when it was all the year 73 when it was all knocked down and plastered. And people were moved out, and they made Jerusalem a bunch of heaps and prohibited anybody from living there for several decades. And then in 135, it was destroyed again, and they moved them out and prohibited Jews from living there for about 1,900 years or so. It was a long time. But anyway, they got to realizing, okay, then the focus is not on this temple, it's on the end of the world. Did you know that the Bible focuses on the end of the world? Now, I'm not Chicken Little going around saying the sky is falling, the sky is falling. But the sky is going to roll back like a scroll, the Bible says. Something's going to happen to this world. The world was not intended to last billions of years with humans on it. The world has a trajectory, and anybody who knows the law of multiplication, or I should say the law of increasing population, you'll see how it increases. God had to know from the very start that it was going to be a something around the thousands of years, not millions of years, because population increases very regularly, conditioned on what kind of procreation you have. And our type, the human type of procreation, it's a certain period, it's a certain rate. So it comes to a point, it comes to a head. Now, the reason why I started here in Matthew 24 is because last week I ended up with the sign of the end of the end of the world. The sign of his coming was the restoration of Israel. We read many verses that talk about Israel being restored to its land, and there are many more than the ones we read. There is one in Matthew 24. If you'll look at verse 32, Jesus gives us a parable. You might have heard this parable before, and its interpretation. I'm going to just briefly show it to you. It says, "Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, you know that summer is nigh. So likewise, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors." Interesting phrase, right? At the doors. Verse 34, "Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled." The idea is this is a parable of the fig tree, and it says when you see it shoot forth leaves, it starts getting green, well, then you know summer's coming, right? Just like a little while ago, about the first week of February, we looked out and the ash trees had budded. Oh, they had budded. They were all turning green. Ash trees are in San Antonio, they're the first ones that turn green. And so you think, okay, it's spring, winter's over. A week later, or 2 weeks later, we get one of the worst freezes we've had on record at that time. And you'll see that all those ash trees just went brown. I don't know if the trees are dead, if they can survive that, but I know other trees, if they bud before they freeze, they die. They don't survive. I hope the ash trees, actually, I can't stand ash trees, but I don't want them all to die on the same day. So anyway, you see the fig tree, if it bursts forth leaves, you say, something's coming. Well, that just makes sense. Something's coming. You can tell the future. You can tell the future. Jesus criticized the Pharisees because he says, you can look at the sky and say, look, it's going to rain today. And he says, and yet you can't tell the signs of the times? He rebuked them. I used to, in Mexico, I'd tell them, you guys go to the tianguis, you go to the open-air market, and you can pick up an avocado, and you can shake it, and you can pop it, and you can squeeze it, and you can say, this is a good one. Now, I can't, but some people can. And you can't read the Bible and understand what it's telling you about the final days of the world. One thing is a whole lot more important than the other. And so if you can tell something like it's going to rain today, well, why don't you start looking and see if you can find out whether or not his coming is near. Now, somebody will tell you, oh, these are crazy people talking about the end of the world. It's like we got a sign, you know, on both sides of us walking around saying, judgment's coming, damnation is coming, what have you. And those are the street preachers. They'll show it to you in cartoonish type of ways. They want to show you that we're crazy because we talk about the end of the world. I want you to know everybody is talking about the end of the world now, not just crazy Christians. Everybody. The president stands up and talks about climate change and we've got one generation to save our world. Well, hello? When Christians say it, you say we're crazy. Now you guys are talking about it. I'm showing you how you can see the day approaching. This is not a mystery. And we're not crazy for saying what's going to happen at the end of the world. Why is this world winding up? It is. Winding up or winding down. I don't know how. It's going to stop abruptly. The world is going to be ended by God. It's not going to fade away in billions of years. It's not going to be engulfed by the sun in billions of years. That's not how we're going to end. The Bible says there is a trajectory and you can see it when it gets close. Now, this is something repeated many times in the Bible. If you have doubts about the Bible, I understand why you would be skeptical about what I'm saying. But if you believe the Bible, then you know what I'm telling you is true. You can see the day is getting close. We talked about Israel's restoration. The Bible several times talks about the land of Israel being like a fig tree. I'm just going to give you some points. Let's see. Let's see if I can find them. Look at Hosea 9:10. Hosea. That comes after Daniel, which comes after Ezekiel. Hosea chapter 9 and verse 10. I found Israel like grapes in the wilderness. I saw your fathers as the first ripe in the fig tree at her first time. But they went to Baal Peor, etc., etc. He calls them like a fig tree and like a vine or like a grape, a grape harvest. All right, look at some more. Look at Joel 1:7. Joel comes next. It's the next book after the book of Hosea. Look at chapter 1. Now look at verse 7. He hath laid my vine waste and barked my fig tree, talking about the destruction of the land of Israel, made it clean bare. Go ahead and look a little farther down at verse 12. The vine is dried up, the fig tree languished, the pomegranate tree, etc. All of these, it's talking about the destruction of the land of Israel. And he says all of these trees have been destroyed that way. Trying to give you a clue what Jesus is talking about when he says there's a parable about the fig tree. Chapter 2, verse 21. Says, fear not, O land, be glad. I must have read that wrong. 22, sorry. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring, for the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. So there is a point that the fig trees and the vines and these other trees are all destroyed when the land is being punished. And so when you see the fig tree blossom, it's the parable is that the land begins to blossom again. They begin to be restored. And there are many others, but let's just look at Matthew 21, 19 to see another parable similar. Maybe it's a parable, I think it is. Anyway, and he left them and went out of the city, verse 17, Bethany, unto Bethany, and he lodged there. Now in the morning, as he returned into the city, he hungered. And when he saw a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing thereon but leaves only, and said unto it, let no fruit grow on thee henceforward forever. And presently the fig tree withered away. And when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, how soon is the fig tree withered away? I think that is a parable about that generation of Jews being cursed because there was no fruit on them. There's another one. Look at Luke 13 and verse 6. Luke 13 and verse 6. He spake also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon and found none. Then said he unto the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree and find none. Cut it down, why cumbereth it the ground? And he answering said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also till I shall dig about it and dung it. And if it bear fruit, well, and if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. That was in his teaching on his Jerusalem journey. It's interesting to me to see how many times the fig tree is talked about sort of in a parable way. And I'm not exactly sure whether we can be dogmatic that it's the land of Israel flowering or whether it's the religion of Israel or whether it's these, the certain generation, the people. You can try to aim that. You can try to figure it out. Some people will spend more time speculating about this than I, and you could probably find books that'll talk about it. Just Jesus says there is a parable when the fig tree blossoms. Now we know Israel was restored to its land. Back in the 1800s, they began to flock back to the land of Israel by the droves. With the impulse of Christian evangelical preaching that Israel was going to be restored to their land. And then the Zionist movement came about. And then in 1917, there were some generals in the British Army during World War I that instead of going after the Ottoman Empire where their strategic force was, they decided to go in and take over Palestine. You can read the stories about these generals and the reason why they did it. And Lloyd George and that fellow named Balfour, and they all had this idea that they were going to take away the land of Israel from the Ottoman Empire during this war in order to establish the nation of Israel again. And then it happened in 1948. Even the United Nations agreed to give them that land in 1948. And in 1949, after the war, they established their borders as they were in the pre-67. And then in 1967, they were attacked again, and they took over all of that land west of the Jordan River. It was an amazing thing that God has placed the people of Israel back in their land. If that doesn't wake you up to say the Bible knows what it's talking about. There is an end of the world coming. Now, I started out this series thinking I would finish it in 3 Sundays. I was going to say, take the first Sunday and talk about the anticipation of the day. And you ought to be anticipating the day. I was going to take the second Sunday and talk about how we can see the day approaching. And then I was going to take the third Sunday and tell you what the Bible tells you you ought to be doing if you see the day approaching. Because there's lots of exhortations in the Bible telling you how to live if you can see the day approaching. I've wound up spending now four Sundays on it, and I'm not even done with my second point. I'm not even close to being done with my second point. But the point that I'm trying to get to is there is an exhortation in the Bible how you are supposed to live if you can see his day approaching. So the important thing is for you to see it. First of all, the Bible always anticipates this day. Then he says you can tell. It can convince you that it's coming and that it's soon. And if that's true, how are you supposed to live? It ought to change the way you think. Now, if you think just by self-discipline, you're going to stop lying, you're going to stop fornicating, you're going to stop being worldly, you think just by self-discipline, no, you got to be convinced of something. You got to be persuaded in your mind of something. And when you see that Jesus Christ has told you the truth and that the days are coming to pass, it can change, radically change your way of living. And if it were to do that, if it would radically change your way of living, God would bless. He would turn it into something fruitful and bountiful and blessing. God would bless if you could become convinced that the day is near and it changed the way you live. That is the reason why for this whole study. Now, that was Israel's restoration. That was one sign of his coming. If you're there in Matthew 24, I want you to see. Just read on a little bit farther than what I read. Verse 4 says, Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass. But the end is not yet. All right, there are two things he says that are going to happen that you ought to be paying attention to. False prophets and false Christs are going to come and try to deceive people. And then he says, there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. And then he says, the end is not yet. Now, is that a sign that the end is close? No, probably not. He says, the end is not yet. That's not what he's talking about. That's not the end. Wars and rumors of wars. There's always been wars and rumors of wars. There's always been false prophets and false Christs. They've been coming all along. And there are still wars, and there are still false prophets. He's just warning Christians during all of this time, pay attention, don't be fooled by false Christs and false prophets. They're going to come, and they're going to say, Christ has come, come with us. Dress in a white robe, and let's stand out on this mountain. He says, don't believe them. So the Jehovah's Witnesses say, he came in 1914. But what he said was, when I come, everybody from one end of heaven to the other is going to see me. That's what he said. And so when a Jehovah's Witness tells me he came in 1914 secretly, I can tell them, no, you are false. Look what it says here. You see, that's a good point that you ought to make with them. He did not come in 1914. We would see him if he had. But he is coming. And it is getting close. All right, there's another point to be made there. Keep reading. Verse 7, for nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Now we're starting to get toward the end. This is more or less what we're talking about. But let me ask you something. Has there been nation against nation and kingdom against kingdom rising up throughout all of history? All of history. Always been these kind of wars. And there shall be famines. Have there been famines all through history? Oh, we can just lay up. If you do some reading of history, you want to talk about people suffering. People have been suffering throughout history. Famines and pestilences. You think COVID is hard? COVID is nothing compared to some of the pestilences that have come. Talk about the Black Plague or talk about the smallpox epidemics that killed 90% of Americans. They say that when the first Spanish explorers went along the eastern seaboard of the United States, back in those days there was no United States, but this was in the 1500s, they were sailing up there. They said that every single cove, every prominent place had houses and cities and lights. They were burning torches all along the seaboard. One generation later, less than 50 years later, when they went back, the English went back there, and it was an abandoned, deserted place. You ought to read the story of Squanto. Squanto is an interesting, fascinating history. Read him. He's the one that helped the pilgrims out because he knew English. Strange thing, this Indian knew English. He had gotten captured. They think by Portuguese or possibly Spaniards, but he had gotten captured as an Indian, and he was taken to Spain and or Portugal, and he was there for a long time, and then he escaped and got to England, learned English, and then he decided he wanted to go home. And so he got on a Spanish ship, got back over to the country of Mexico, Veracruz, and walked his way all the way back up to Massachusetts, what is now Massachusetts. And he got to his hometown, and there was nobody there. All his family was dead. The city was gone. It was just ruins. Everything along the whole way was ruins. The entire population of his world had died. And so he was there living with a few survivors in another tribe. And these English people show up. And he speaks English. And he belongs to no tribe. And so he joins them and helps them tremendously. I think of that as providence. You want to study it from some other viewpoint, you can. I see God doing something there, and it's amazing to me. But the story tells you that a pestilence came and killed the entire population of his hometown. And it wasn't just his. They say the Spaniards, when they sailed up the first time up the Mississippi, they've got records of it. You can read about these in a book that I read. It's called 1491. Tremendous book. Tells you how it used to be before the Columbus came. So in 1491, but it says these Spaniards went up the Mississippi River as far as they could go, past St. Louis, way up there. And it says along the both banks, all the way up there, there were villages. But 65 years, 75 years later, there was nobody. The entire population got wiped out. Pestilences? Oh, yeah. COVID's nothing, folks. COVID is nothing. I'm not saying not to worry about it. I'm just saying it's not comparable to the kind of pestilences that have been on in history. All right? So when he says there's going to be all these things, these are the beginning of sorrows, we're talking about the church age watching it happen all the way along. And he gets a little bit farther. He says there's going to be earthquakes. You know, when I was a young man, I heard preachers say that earthquakes are getting worse. But then I've actually done some research, and no, earthquakes are not getting worse. There have been earthquakes. Now, they might in the future. I don't know. You know, next week we might have some earthquakes that get worse. I don't know. But there have been some really, really bad earthquakes. They talk about that Krakatoa one, that the thing was felt thousands of miles away. And it sent out so much ash into the atmosphere that there was a severe winter, worst on record, the next year. And several years later, the winters were worse because of the ash in the atmosphere. They said a certain percentage, I don't remember if it was 60, 70% of all the cattle in the United States died that year from the severe winter, froze to death out in the fields. All right. These are not very good signs about how close the Lord is to come back. I don't think that's how you can see. I think the restoration of Israel is a good sign. But earthquakes? Not so sure about that until we find some if they start happening now, we might then say, okay, this is different. But we haven't seen the kind of earthquakes that would tell us the sign that he's clear. Famines and pestilences and wars. Now, wars, that might be something, because we've had some of the worst wars within the last 100 years that have ever been imagined. Literally hundreds of millions of people killed. We have weapons of war now that would make all the wars in history seem like small. Although there was one battle mentioned in the Old Testament where it says there was 500,000 people killed. That's some severe battle, folks, when 500,000 people die in hand-to-hand combat. That's pretty bad. Anyway, no, I'm not looking for those kind of signs. I just don't see it there. But I do see some signs. And I think if you can be convinced that there are some serious signs of his close approach, he's coming, and that he's coming soon. Let's go to another one. I want you to look at Revelation chapter 14 and verse 15. This is the one I call the harvest. The end of the world is compared to a harvest. Revelation 14, verse 15. And another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him that sat on the cloud, "Thrust in thy sickle and reap, for the time has come for thee to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe." This is the end when God says, okay, the earth is ripe. The earth is likened to a fruit. And when the fruit is just a bud, you think, no, not ready. When it gets bigger and thicker but still green, you think, no, not ready. And it gets bigger and bigger and it's still green, you say, nope, not ready. But when that apple turns red, yeah, then you start thinking, about time. We used to go out to the Dalrosses when they would have their peach harvest, and they'd pay us to go out and help harvest because you had just a few little days, I guess, or weeks to get all of those peaches harvested. And we'd go, and boy, it was hot, man. It was hot and sticky and sweaty and all that. But boy, you worked hard from sunup to sundown and picked all the peaches you could pick because you had just a narrow window in which to pick them. And that's what God is saying. The earth is like a fruit. And when it gets ripe, I'm going to pick it. Well, what does this mean then? How is it ripe? Well, there are two ways to see it as ripe. I'm going to deal mainly with the one way because there's another sign that deals with the other way. Look at Genesis chapter 9. Actually, before we go to Genesis chapter 9, let's go to Genesis chapter 1. Look at verse 28. Let's start with verse 27 so Brent don't get on me. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. What was God's command to Adam and Eve? Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Now, that word replenish does not mean fill it up again. It means fill it up completely. Just like something is replete with something, it's not filled up again. It's filled up completely from beginning to end. That's the idea. What did God tell them? Be fruitful and multiply and fill up the earth all the way. Get it full, every corner of it. You want to know what it means when it says the earth is ripe? It means it's full. It's replenished. It's replete with people. Now, I don't know if you've ever driven out in the desert. Doesn't look like there's anybody there. But you go over a little hill and there's hundreds, maybe even thousands of people hawking animals on the side of the road. No, seriously, I'm talking about in Mexico. You go through these deserts and you look out there and you don't really see any lights or roads or anything, but you're driving and then there's people there. And they're selling rattlesnakes, and they're selling, you know, raccoons, and they're selling, you know, ground squirrels, and they're selling things because they want to make a living. Why? Because they live right there. You stop and ask them where they live, right over there. They're we would drive down these places. We would go because we'd show films or whatever. We'd go out into these places where you'd say, okay, there's nobody there, but every hill you cross, there's a town there. There's a town there, and we'd show the films, and then we'd go and look, and they'd tell us about another town. Man, we went to this one town. It was out in the middle of nowhere, but there was a train station there. had 3,000 or 4,000 people living in that town, but it was not connected by any kind of pavement. It was only connected by railroad. It was called Estación Bocas, which means the Bocas is the name of it. It's the train depot Bocas. That was the name of the town. Thousands of people lived in that town. The world has been filled up. Do you know that there are hundreds of cities, what they call mega cities. Mega cities meaning more than 10 million people. Now, there's not that many in the New World, but there's an awful lot of them over there in the Old World. There's like 50 mega cities in China. There's a bunch of them in India. Cities that you've never heard of that have way more people than San Antonio. The world has filled up. You know that every day on the news, they're talking about how we can't sustain this. They talk about sustainable whatever. If they sell you milk, they'll say raised sustainably. You know what they're saying? They're saying we can't keep living the way we've been living because we're going to run out of stuff. I remember them telling us that there was not going to be enough petroleum in the ground to finish out this century. That was the last century. Well, they found some more. But everybody knows it's limited. Everybody knows it. There is a limit to how much we can do. There's a limit to how many people can fit. Now, that limit's not shoulder to shoulder, maybe. But you realize how much arable land you have to make one person survive? Folks, the earth is ripe when it's full of people. And what does the Bible say? It's like a harvest. When the earth is ripe, the time is near. Everybody knows the earth is ripe. So God gave you the sign, he gave you the indication, the indicator, and he says, pay attention to this indicator, because when you see this happen, you know it's close. Because God wants you to know it's close. The world is filling up. You know what that means? There's a day coming, and it's a day of glory, but it's a day of wrath, and it's a day of vengeance, and it's a day of culmination of history. It's a day when God's going to do what he intended to do. And it's getting near. How do we know? Because every time I'm telling you what, just go onto your Google and just type in cities and go to images. I shouldn't say Google. Go to DuckDuckGo or some other place. Forget Google. Go do something and just look up the images and see the pictures of cities you've never heard of. Incredible, incredible. You think New York has a lot of big, tall buildings? Try Shanghai. Try Hong Kong. You're talking about 20 million people in one little chunk of land? And this is repeated hundreds of times throughout the world. You go into the middle of Arabia and there are huge cities. Go right in the middle of Mexico, a landlocked city with 20 million people in a valley under two volcanoes that are still active, still spit out stuff ever so often. Talk about danger, man. What I'm trying to tell you is that the Bible says there is a way to know when the earth is getting close. And the earth is getting close when it gets filled. Look at Genesis chapter 9, just to reiterate or reconfirm what I'm saying here. Verse 1. Genesis 9:1, and God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. God wants the earth full. Why? Because when it gets full, he's going to do something. And it's going to be glorious to him. That's his plan from the start. He says, fill it up. I want the place full. And then he talks all the way through the Bible. He talks about these prophecies that they're going to come from the farthermost, utmost islands of the sea. And they're going to be bringing him glory. From the utmost islands. Did you know that God wants all the islands full? And just about all of them are. You got people living on all those islands out there. Been doing it for a long time, folks. You know what God is telling you? You can see the day approaching. I wonder how complacent are you going to be If you can see that God has had this planned all along and it's reaching the point of ripeness. It's there. It's close. You say, well, do I have a whole nother generation? I don't know. But you can see the day approaching. You can't tell the day and the hour. You don't know when it's going to happen. Stop telling us what date it's going to happen. Don't listen to the Mayan calendar and don't listen to Y2K and don't listen to camping telling you it's 1988. Too late. You were wrong. But you can see the day approaching. And it ought to change the way you think. All right. Let's look at a couple more and I'll end on that one. Look at Joel 3. We've been there before this morning. So get back to Joel. I'm sure you kept your finger on it. It's right after Hosea, right before Amos. Or a few dozen pages before Matthew. Joel chapter 3, and look at verse 13. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come get ye down, for the press is full, the fats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Another point of ripeness is wickedness. It's going to be harvested when it gets to a certain point of wickedness. And what does the other sign that it says? It says over there, it says, I didn't get to that point, but it says in Matthew chapter 24, it says, because wickedness shall abound, or iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. You get toward the end, and wickedness begins to abound. Look at, let's skip that one. Let's go to, what happened? Oh, yeah. Look at Genesis 15. I do not have enough time to do a good survey of this part, but it's going to be several months before I get back on it, so I'll give you something to chew on while you're waiting. Genesis 15, look at verse 16. But in the, I've got to read the context, I always get to it. Look at verse 13. Genesis 15, 13. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance. And thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace, thou shalt be buried in a good old age. But in the fourth generation they shall come hither again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. I want to point out to you that this is a very important point, and that is that Abraham was promised a certain part of land. He says, this land that you've been walking on, this land of Canaan, it's yours. I cursed Canaan a long time ago for my own reasons, because of his father, what he did. And he says, so I cursed Canaan, and now Canaan has gone into some serious sin, and I'm going to give you this land, just not yet. Well, Lord, why not now? Abraham says, well, what's wrong? Right now? I want it right now. No, their sin isn't full. You got to wait 400 years for their sin to become full before I judge them. You see how God works? He says, no, I can't give it to you right now because I'm not going to put in the sickle until their wickedness is full. So he makes Abram and all his seed wait, and they have to be slaves, and they got to go over there to Egypt, and they got to wander, and they have all this affliction for 400 years. And why? Because these wicked Amorites aren't wicked enough yet for God to say, I'm putting in the sickle. Now, what that tells you is that when wickedness gets to a certain point, God reaps. God visits. Isn't that what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah? Didn't God come down and say, I've heard that the wickedness is really bad in this city. I've come to check it out. And he sent two angels in there, and they said, yep, it's pretty bad. And the next day, God rained fire and brimstone from heaven onto those four cities. Boom. You see, because God says, I'm looking at the wickedness. One way to tell about the ripeness of the earth, about the sickle, about God saying the time is coming, it's coming close, is how wicked are people? How much have they deviated from God's design? How much homosexuality will God put up with? How much fornication? How much murder? How much thievery? How much materialism? How much evil in the world? How many little 10-year-old girls have to be raped before God says, I'm done? And if you start thinking about the kind of wickedness that's out there right now, all the human trafficking and the drug trafficking and all the evil, evil that is out there, and all of the promotion of the most wicked things right now by our most highest government officials, you got to say, the harvest has got to be getting close. If you know how God thinks, then you know the day is approaching. I do not have time to keep going on this subject, but I will start it back up in June.
Let's go ahead and take our seat. Or take our place this morning. We're going to stand and sing number 215.
Silver nor gold hath obtained my redemption.
Of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We're going to be now in 208. This is an important question if you have not answered this.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood? Are they white as
232, when I see the blood.
Christ our Redeemer died on the cross, died for the sinner, paid all his due. Sprinkle your robe with the blood of the Lamb, and I will pass over you.
This is true. Amen. There's nothing else to trust in. Open for sin, and I will pass over you.
Sun does rise, does get warm again, and the water does flow. For some of you, maybe too much because you haven't repaired the leak yet, but good to see each and every one of you this morning. We do have some announcements I'd like to make, so please bear with me. First of all, there's some prayer requests. We need to pray for Robert Perez. I believe today, this morning, he's having an operation on his foot. So they're going to be removing that foot, as I understand. So we need to pray for him, pray the operation goes well and that he recovers. We need to remember a missionary, maybe we don't know, Pamela Beltran in Albania. She has COVID, and they're very concerned for her, and they have asked for prayers, so you pray for them. John and Karen will be heading back this Tuesday. Pray for their travels as they travel back into Mexico. And that God will protect them. Matt and Lauren, I'm not sure when they're headed back. Oh, same day? Okay. So Matt and Lauren as well. I thought they were going to be here longer. I'm sorry. So Matt and Lauren as well. Don't want to forget them. Thursday at 7 o'clock, Bill's going to have his study again. I understand it's going very well. So if you'd like to come, that's Thursday at 7 o'clock. There's going to be a women's meeting, our conference, on the 10th of April. It's a Saturday. All of you ladies are encouraged to come, and there's a sign-up sheet in the hallway that you can sign up. There is a request for men to volunteer as guards and as also as servants to serve the meals that they're going to have for the ladies, opportunity us to minister to the ladies as they have ministered on us so many times. So we're thankful for that. I think that's all that I have on my list. Of course, we have our meetings tonight at 7 o'clock. We'd encourage you to come because we do have the Lord's Supper and we have an open meeting. And if I may, I just want to address the brethren out there in cyberspace. I would want to encourage you. I want to remind you that we do pray for you. We do miss you. And we would encourage you to diligently pray, what is the ending strategy for you? What is the exit strategy? Is this going to continue for how long? Have you prayed about it? Have you considered what is some of the things that I can do as you're fighting this COVID pandemic? So just pray about that, because I know some of us were able to go shopping, we're able to go to work, or we're able to go to school. Maybe we ought to think about, well, maybe we're also able to attend church when we consider these things. Just remember that we are in a battle. We want the best for you, but we just ask you to pray, what is your strategy? What is your plan? What is it the Lord would have you to do? And if the Lord would have you to stay home to protect your family, great. We will rejoice with that. We'll pray with you. We'll encourage you. But we do want you to consider this is a battle. We need you. We miss you. We love you. We want the fellowship. We miss the words of wisdom. We miss your spirit. And so we would like to, you know, get our church back together. And so just consider that. Be praying one for another. It's difficult times. It's hard to make decisions. But just remember the Lord in our decision. I think so, that's one of the things that I got out of the revival meeting. We need to remember this is the Lord's work, and we need to consider what is it the Lord wants us to do, and not just be reactionary maybe to the news or different things that the government is telling us. We need to consider, what does the Lord want us to do? And if you feel the Lord wants you to stay home, there's no condemnation, there's no burden, we just rejoice with you. I just want to remind you that we are in a battle, that there are some things that we need to consider as far as the Lord's perspective, and I encourage you to do that. So I believe Brother Brian's going to come preach for us after the special music. Amen? Praise the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
Thank you.
Church actually almost looks full. This is great. We are going to start off this morning in Matthew in chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11, excuse me, we'll start off in verse 16. But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows and saying, we have piped unto you and you have not danced. We have mourned unto you and you have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he hath a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, behold, a man gluttonous and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. And let's pray and ask God's blessing. Lord, we are aware that without you, we can do nothing. Lord, you're the one that has power and control. You're the one that has the ability to touch men's hearts. And I pray, Lord, that you'd speak through me and use your word to touch the hearts of those that are listening here today. Lord, whatever the need is, Lord, whatever it is, we just want to be free for you to move among us. And I pray that you just give me the words to speak and help me to honor you and honor the truth of your word as we speak. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Matthew chapter 11 is an interesting chapter. In Matthew chapter 11 and 12, we begin to see an incredible transition in the book. And we find that the ones that he came to save are the ones that are rejecting him. And there's a passage in here. I'm not going to deal with the whole passage, but there is a phrase in here that I've been thinking about. I've just been going over and over in my mind, and it stems from the accusation that they had against not only John, but against Jesus. They accused John of because he neither ate or drank, and he was out there in the wilderness and fasted a lot and lived a very austere life. That they accused him of having a devil, of being devil possessed. And that's a pretty serious accusation over the forerunner, the greatest prophet that God put on earth. But they were very glib and very light in their accusation of him. And then Jesus came eating and drinking, and he had a totally different approach. And their accusation of Jesus Christ is that, number one, that he's a glutton. Number two, that he's a drunk. And number three, that he's a friend of publicans and sinners. And the way that they said this is you can almost detect the sneer in their voice, the disdain that they had of Jesus Christ. And these were Pharisees. These were religious leaders that accused Jesus Christ of these things. And you can pretty much get the gist of what their attitude towards Jesus Christ was. Very negative attitude. And we know some of the reasons why. One of the reasons is he exposed their hypocrisy publicly. And that's never a pleasant thing. They were very, very proud of their outward righteousness. And Jesus just tore their outward righteousness to shreds. And didn't leave any room for doubt that they were whited sepulchers, that they were righteous on the outside but wicked on the inside. And of course, this hurt them very deeply, and he exposed their hypocrisy, and also he did not give them the honor that they felt that they were due. And this comes, you know, from just our humanity, our inward wickedness and our sinfulness. And you see it all the time. There are certain religious leaders that feel like they ought to get honor. And not to mention any particular denominations, but hold on. Hair. Not to mention any particular denominations, but Catholicism has very, very much honor given towards men. I grew up in it, and we were taught that the leaders, the bishops, the archbishops, the pope, the priests were worthy of more honor than what God ever intended for man to have, to the point where they could do no wrong. They were accused of sins, and it was like, you know, you just kind of brushed that off to the side. And many of them, they enjoyed that honor. They enjoyed being called father. They enjoyed being stood out and being called out. I'm telling you that God never intended his ministers to be in such a position where others would come and kiss the ring on his hand and give him that kind of honor. God never intended a human being to be in that kind of a position. God intended his ministers to be servants among the people. And God didn't create any kings or small gods in the church. But these Pharisees, and we see it earlier on in the book of Matthew chapter 6, his advice to them, his advice is very clear. He says, you know, don't be like them, that they love open air prayers in the market. They love to be called rabbi. They enlarge the borders of their garments so that they can be seen of men. And they do these things so that they can have the reputation of men. And Jesus just tore all that to shreds and exposed it for what it really was. And the religious crowd, they hated him. There was no doubt. They disdained him. They despised him. They wanted him gone. They wanted him dead. And so their accusation was that he's a glutton. He's a drunk. He hangs out with publicans and sinners. Now, publicans are not the stellar citizens of the time. They're extortioners. They took more than what they deserved. They collected taxes, and then on top of the taxes that they collected more for themselves. They had an incredible reputation for being traitors to the nation, for being collectors of the taxes of Rome, and so they didn't. I'm sure that there may have been some honest publicans, but generally their reputation was not good at all. And then just sinners in general. Prostitutes and drunks and people that had messed up their lives. And this is their accusation of Jesus, that he's a friend of sinners. You got to be careful of the labels that are given to God. There are some labels that in the Bible, they are so clear and they are so distinct. When the word describes Jesus Christ as being a prophet, it is very specific. It is referring to a very distinct part of his personality, of his function. This is referred to as a priest, as a king. We know what those things mean. These are labels that are given to God. When he is an advocate, it is a very specific label that's given. This is one label that it seems like men have latched onto that was given to him by his enemies, with a sneer that he's a friend of publicans and sinners. And the reason why I want to bring this up is because there are many, many people, I talked to some just recently, that hide behind this particular phrase and try to justify their sins because they think that Jesus is their friend. And I want you to know that that in many cases, Jesus is not your friend. What is a friend? Friends, someone, you know, that hang out. They hang out together. When you've got friends, what do you have? You have some common interest. You have some common desires, maybe some common goals, some common experiences. But does Jesus have anything in common, really, with these sinners? I want you to look and consider a couple of points here. I want to take this particular accusation, and I want to give some misconceptions that people have when they hear this phrase, Jesus, friend of sinners that was given to him by his enemies. Think first of all that maybe it's an attempt to bring the Lord down to our level. Think about this for a minute. This is what men want to do. If they can bring God down to our level, then he's easily managed. He can be approached in a different way. I want to illustrate it by looking at a verse in the New Testament. Look at 1 Peter in chapter 4, 4. We were just talking recently about a very, very popular holiday in the West of Christmas, and we were discussing, as we were talking about this, we were discussing the incredible disconnect that there seems to be, because it's actually a very, very popular holiday with the world, and yet the world that promotes this holiday actually hates the Jesus that is preached during that holiday. And so they give lip service to Jesus, but actually, in all actuality, they don't. And look what it says in 1 Peter chapter 4, in verse 3. It says, "For the time past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles when we walked in lasciviousness, lusts, excess of wine, revelings, banquetings, and abominable idolatries." So in this passage right here, it's describing what? Something in the future, something present, or something past? For the Christian, it ought to be describing the past life, our old life. This is what we were before we had an encounter with Jesus Christ. We were full of all of these things, the lasciviousness, that sexual lust, and sins and lust, that's all kinds of inordinate fleshly desires. Drunkenness and revelings, that's parties and banquetings and idolatries, worshiping everything but God. That's our past life. Then he says in verse 4, he says, "Wherein they think it strange that you run not with them to the same excess of riot, speaking evil of you." So there's going to be people that are going to speak evil of you when you clean up your act. It's an amazing thing. As long as you're wicked, as long as your life is all messed up, you're good with your friends. But then all of a sudden, when Jesus comes in and turns your life around and you start acting different, they start looking at you and they say, "Man, what are you doing?" I remember the transition. I remember that I had nothing but lost friends. And we were tight and we were good. And then I got saved. And then all of a sudden, my world was rocked like you wouldn't believe. Everything changed. Everything I saw looked different. And I started wanting, not out of obligation or out of duty, but I started craving going to church. Really, I couldn't wait for Sunday. I couldn't wait for Friday night Bible study. I couldn't wait to hear more and begin hearing things out of the Word, and it seemed like everything was new, and I wanted to talk about it. I wanted to talk about what Jesus had done. I remember I was in the barracks one time, and I was praying, and somebody, "What are you doing?" Seriously, I'm bowing, you know, so it. Obvious that I'm praying, you know. Got my Bible out of here. "Oh, so you're a religious man now, huh?" "Well, no, not exactly, because I'm just a worm. I'm no man, you know. Jesus saved me." Oh, and believe me, after that, man, the eyes upon any little thing. "Oh, religious man. That's how religious man hacks, huh?" "Well, no, you know, I'm not perfect. I'm just forgiven, you know." Saying I'm good, I'm just saying that Jesus belongs to me, I belong to him. But man, the relationship changed. And believe me, the pressure to drag me back down. Some of you have experienced it, right? You get saved, you want to live, and your friends aren't going to have anything of it. They're going to want you. You know, if you really were my friend, and you know I'm trying to get clean, why would you even offer me something to put me back into bondage? If I'm trying to stop drinking and honor the Lord, then what is it your business? Why would you want to offer me alcohol all over again? It's right there. They think it's strange that you run not with them to the same excess of riot. And then they speak evil of you. You didn't do anything wrong, but their opinion of you completely changed. That's the opinion that they had of Jesus Christ. They had opinion. We used to live like them. Now we don't. And believe me, they don't understand it, they don't like it, and they don't want it. Jesus came on the scene, and he wasn't dancing according to their tune. He wasn't singing according to their pipe. He was doing things different. He was trying to teach them a better way. He was trying to get them to understand what God's will is, and they would have nothing of it. Is it possible that maybe some people, when they think of Jesus as being a friend, they want him to be a buddy? They want to bring him down. And that's why I have a hard time calling Jesus my co-pilot. It almost kind of cheapens what he really is. Jesus isn't my co-pilot. Jesus is the plane. He's the seat, you know. I'm telling you, he's everything. He's not some little helper over on the side. He's not some little person that I can call just when I'm in trouble. No, I'm telling you, he's more than just a little friend I've got over on the side. And he doesn't condone our behavior. They were trying to insult him by saying, "Oh, you're over there eating with the publicans and sinners. That must mean you like extortion. That must mean that you really enjoy sitting with prostitutes putting ointment on your feet. That must mean you really like to be hanging out with these kinds of guys." And it is a misunderstanding of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. And just because Jesus was found eating with publicans and sinners, and by the way, I thank God that he decided to eat with publicans and sinners. I thank God that one day he was walking along and pointed up to Zacchaeus and said, "Hey, come down, I'm going to eat at your house today." Thank God that he intervened with the woman who was taken in adultery in the very midst, and he intervened on her behalf. Thank God that there are people that are going to be in heaven that had some of the most notorious lives. I think of Rahab and others, you know, and how God just changed their life and turned it around. But don't misinterpret and think that Jesus was hanging out with them because he was attracted to the way that they lived. Some people are like that. They think Jesus can be their friend and they don't have to change. But what happened when Zacchaeus had a direct confrontation with Jesus Christ? He said, "Man, all the extortion, anything, if I've wronged any man, I'm going to restore it fourfold. I give half of my goods." He just began giving his wealth away. He completely changed. I'm telling you, he did tell the woman, he said, "Well, if no man's condemned me, I don't condemn you," when she was taken in adultery. But then he told her, he said, "You go and sin no more." You see, there's a big difference. Jesus isn't, he isn't at our level. He's not hanging out with publicans and sinners because he identifies with them and because they're compatible with him and because they have common goals and interests and desires. That's not why he was. He's not being that kind of a friend. Also, this accusation can bring a real dangerous precedent, because then we get the idea that God is condoning our unrighteousness. And what you have to understand is Jesus had to come down really low to eat with publicans and sinners. Their business activities disgusted him. You know how I know? You look back in the Old Testament and look at what God's plan was. God says, man, don't use an unjust scale. He said, you give everybody that which is good and right. Don't use deceit in your business practices. Don't steal. You know, he had very clear guidelines about how human beings should act. And so their business practices, their deceit, their running over poor people, I mean, it just disgusted him. And don't think that he was enamored with the actions of drunks and prostitutes. God hates drunkenness. God hates fornication. God hates all of these self-serving sins. God doesn't love these things. It's not like he's... I talked with a young guy one time, a long time ago, and I was trying to reason with him. And I noticed that over the course of time, his dress started changing. And the way that he wore his hair started changing a little bit. And it looked like he was trying to look a little more like a gang member. And it was almost like he idolized them. And I started talking to him. I said, man, why do you want to look like these guys? These guys are losers. They're headed for nothing. But he kind of looked up to them, you know? I'm telling you, that's a real mistake. God didn't look up to these guys. God didn't have respect for the publicans and the sinners, and God didn't have respect for you. By the way, I don't know if you understand it, but God didn't come down to save you because he saw such value in you. Well, there's some people that they think that. Oh man, God's got to accept me. I'm a pretty good specimen of what humanity ought to be. Oh, I'm telling you, you got to read Romans. There is none good. No, not one. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. No, there is none that doeth good. No, not one. God didn't hang out with them because he was attracted to them. Look at 2 Corinthians in chapter 6 and verse 14. Maybe this is what they were accusing him of, you know, that, hey, you know, you're not separating. Because the Pharisees, they separated. They didn't hang out with these guys. They knew what they were. They felt like they were better. But it is true. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 14. And this does not nullify this in any way, shape, or form. He says, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Pretty clear, right? You don't have a yoke where you're pulling together with unbelievers. And he gives the indication why. He says, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he believeth with an infidel? He is talking about a divide that is so wide that you have two parties that are diametrically opposed to each other. That's why we preach to young people and said, hey, you got to be careful who you hang out with. Proverbs says that if you're a companion of fools, you're going to be destroyed. It is just a known fact that you become like the people that you hang out with over time. And so this kid that I was talking to, he was hanging out with the gang members, kind of liked them. And he began to be more and more like him. I always love that proverb that says that that walketh with wise men shall be wise, or maybe counted wise. I don't remember exactly how he says it. But I thought, man, if I'm an idiot, at least I'm going to walk with some good men. But I'll tell you seriously, one of the best decisions I made as a Christian was to hang out with good men. Oh, there's a lot of losers out there. There's a lot of losers out there that'll just drag you down, and they'll drag you right down to the pits with them, but there are some good men. And I started hanging out with some good men. That old man over there, bald head, bleeding arms, you know, 84 years old. He's going to still be here when we're gone, by the way. guy's going to last a long time. But I tell you what, he's a good man. I remember there was a group of guys, and they caught me over, had me over to the house, and they were talking to me. They said, hey, look, you know, this isn't right over at the church, and this isn't right over here, and this isn't right. And I was telling him, I said, man, what do you got? He said, man, why don't you come with us, and then you can be the pastor, and then we can start something new, and we can do this thing right. And I said, well, all you've done so far is criticize a good man. And, oh, so what are you now? Are you a Lindellite? That's what they said to me. Are you a Lindellite? I said, no, I'm not a Lindellite. I know his faults. But he's a good man, and I'm following him. You see, the point is that God takes seriously an unequal yoke. If I had gotten saved and then decided, you know what, I really don't need church, I'm going to hang out with the old crowd, where would my faith be now? I'm telling you, you go down to the docks and you're burdened with something spiritual, those guys aren't going to understand. Where are you going to find people to understand your burdens? What about burden for somebody in your family that's not saved and you want to see them get saved? Do you think the guys down on the dock, they're going to understand that? No, but the guys in church will. And they're going to be able to strengthen you. They're going to be able to help you. Don't misinterpret Jesus coming and hanging out with the publicans and the sinners. Don't misinterpret his intentions. God is serious about separation. God's serious about it. And you got to be careful. You don't have the right just to marry whoever you want to. You got to marry in the Lord. You got to set some good precedents and standards. And if that means you got to be single for a while, then you got to be single for a while. I learned that, and I just finally had to tell the Lord, okay, I'm just going to be single then. Because they were not in tune with what I wanted to do. And God, he gave me a wife that had a lot of the same faith, and she had a lot of the same desires and goals for serving the Lord. It was amazing. And God can. So don't take this phrase and set a dangerous precedent to think that separation. No, it is. When you come to Christ, you are different. You were once a servant of the devil. Now you're the servant of God. Once you were in the kingdom of darkness, now you're in the kingdom of light. Once you served your own lust and flesh and desires, now you serve the will of God. Everything's different. And don't mischaracterize this accusation that they made to think that that God has a high opinion of us. You think God's got a high opinion of you, because he wants to condescend and come to save you. God didn't have a high opinion of these guys, and he doesn't have a high opinion of you either. His opinion of sinners, how does he describe sinners? As glorious, as progressive, as stellar. No, he calls them lost. That's his characterization of a human being. Lost! Out there, lost, on his way to destruction, rebellious. That's his characterization. They're all kinds, gone astray, blind. I mean, you could go and list, have a whole paragraph of adjectives of Jesus Christ's opinion of us. You think God's got a high opinion of humanity? Oh, but you know, you could look back and you could see the history of man. I'm telling you, the history of man is a sorry history. You look even, I mean, God's going to come down and he's going to make a nation, right? He's going to show all these heathen around. He's going to show the Hittites and the Canaanites, and he's going to show all of these wicked, idolatrous nations. He's going to show them his relationship with his people. So he puts Israel right there in the midst. And you think, Israel's got it all, man. They've got the word of God. They've got the revelation of God. They've got the protection of God and the promises of God. They have everything that they need. And yet you look in the Old Testament, every time you turned around, They are just going way off. I'm not talking about just backsliding a little bit on a Saturday afternoon. I'm talking about Moses going up there into the mount and getting the word of God that they're going to live by, and they're down there making a golden calf. God does not have a very high opinion of humanity. He's not hanging out with men because he thinks they're so cool. Oh, you got to see yourself the way God sees you. He sees you lost. He sees you as confused and without a shepherd and deceived. There's a misunderstanding of why Jesus would eat and drink with sinners. Look at Luke chapter 5 in verse 30. Because they did. They wanted to know. And I guess if I was a religious guy, And I was watching Jesus, and he's supposed to be the Messiah. And instead of coming into the temple and getting in with our little religious clique, he's out there in the streets. He's out there with people that have their lives ruined. And they were like, why? Why would you go be a friend of sinners? Well, we already know. Not because he's got a high opinion of you. We already know it's not because he has compatible interests with you. It's not because he thinks your activities are so cool. In fact, he despises your sin. He despises your activities. He condemns them. But look at what he says in Luke chapter 5 and verse 30. But their scribes and Pharisees murmured against his disciples, saying, why do you eat and drink with publicans and sinners? You can almost... sense the disdain in their voice. And Jesus answered and said unto them, they that are whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Latch on to that last phrase there. Sinners to repentance. What was his will and desire for the woman taken in adultery? That she would stop that activity and that she would turn away from that wickedness and that she would sin no more. What was his dreams and desires and goals for Zacchaeus? Was that he would drop off and leave all of his extortion and all of his wicked business practices? What's his dream and goal and desire for you? Is that he would come in and change your life and you'd leave your wickedness. God never intended for you to stay where you are. God wants you to, to come to him, but he wants you to come to him in repentance. You're sick. You're sick with sin. And you're going to die of this sinful disease without any intervention. I think that's amazing. Jesus told us exactly why he comes. And but by the way, Jesus didn't say that the publicans and sinners are my friends. He didn't say, I like these guys. They're my friends. No, this was an accusation made by the religious crowd. Oh, yeah, you're their friend. But Jesus eats and drinks with us because he knows that we don't stand a chance without him. He knows that without his intervention, we die in our sins and we're separated from God for eternity. Jesus didn't come just to demonstrate, although he did some pretty amazing demonstrations about what love is and about what serving your man is, but he came not to save us in our sin. He came to save us from our sin. The Bible says he became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Do not misinterpret why he wants to spend time with us. It's not because he's enamored with us. It's because he wants to save us. To me, that's amazing. The crowds, they've crowded around him because they heard something they never heard before. When it came to outward righteousness, they just gave up. Have you ever given up? Have you ever realized, I just can't do this? I can't be righteous and good. The sinners, they knew that. And when Jesus started talking, he started talking about mercy. He started talking about forgiveness. He started talking about true repentance. And he gave them something that they had not been getting from the Pharisees. Look, you're not going to get this kind of stuff in religion. Go to a religious leader. Go to a Jehovah's Witness. Go to a Catholic priest. Go to anyone out there that's a mainstream religious leader. You know what they're going to tell you? Hey, just try a little harder. Do your best, and maybe one day you're going to make it. Do you realize how disheartening for a young man to be told by one that he admires, a priest, that, you know, I'm not really sure I'm going to get in. I'm going to try, but, you know, it's always got... I'm telling you, it's like, just give up. But Jesus came to save sinners. Jesus came to save them from their sins. Man, that's something that I can get a hold of. You give me a standard and say, do this and you're going to live. I'm going to throw up my hands. But when Jesus came along, he said, man, you're rotten, you're evil, you're undone, you're wicked, you're nasty. And I agreed with that. And then he says, but I'll save you if you'll call upon me. Oh, man, I'm telling you what, when I first clearly understood that salvation was about me taking my old rotten garments and giving them to Jesus, and he in turn gives me robes of pure white, it's an exchange. He takes my sins and gives me righteousness. It blew my mind. I was like, finally, I'm free. I understand what it means to be saved. And he can save you that same way today. He wants you out of your sin. He didn't want you to continue in your wickedness. He doesn't want to continue in your drunkenness. He doesn't want to continue letting you idolize the things of the world. He wants to make a creature out of you. And that's his goal, and that's his desire. Oh, I'm telling you, they sneered. They said, yeah, he's just a friend of sinners. But they didn't understand what he was trying to do. We do. We understand he's trying to save us. And that's pretty cool. Look at one more verse in John chapter 15. Because this is a label that they put on him. Hey, you're a friend of publicans and sinners. But we know he's not really their friend in the sense that we think it. But John chapter 15. In verse 12, it says, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Wow, we could stop there and just repent. Just repent right there. That you love one another as I have loved you. Wow, man, we're a long way from that. It says, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. And yeah, we consider that the ultimate sacrifice when someone gives their life so that another can live. We consider that the ultimate act of love towards somebody else. But look what he says there in verse 14. He says, ye are my friends. Verse stops there. There's nothing after it. Ye are my friends. Oh no, the verse goes on. It says, if you do whatsoever I command you. So what does Jesus value as a friend? Some wicked sinner that's not willing to turn from his ways? No, that man's going to be judged, and he's going to die in his sins. God's intention was never to save you and leave you where you are. He says, you're my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. You know who God considers friends? Those that take heed to his word. Those that value what his commandments are. Those that value obedience. And I understand no man can know the heart, but you know a good outward indication of whether somebody really loves Jesus and considers him a friend is how they act according to his word. There's a lot of people out there that'll give lip service. Jesus warned us of that. He warned us of men that honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Oh, yeah, there are those that are hypocrites, and those they're going to be found out. They're going to become to those in that day And they're going to say, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? And in your name do many, many wonderful works? And then will I confess unto them, I never knew you. You know what the true terms of friendship with Jesus Christ is? Submission to his will, is a valuing of his revelation. Look what he says there in verse 15. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. Isn't that what Jesus has done? He has revealed to us his will. It's not been kept secret. And then he says in verse 16, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should bring forth fruit and that your fruit should remain. I want you to know that coming to Jesus Christ is a life-changing event. There's nothing like it in the world. There's no room for you to give lip service to Jesus Christ and then let that be enough to just give him a little token every now and then. No, God wants you to be his, he said, you're my friends. Who? Which ones? The ones that value his will. How many Christians out there, oh yeah, yeah, I believe in Jesus, but they have no interest in what he commands. They have no interest in what his will and desire is. Their loves and his loves are different. Their desires and his desires are different. There's a disconnect right there. Jesus had called these guys friend. You see, when he hung out with the publicans and sinners, it was so strange to them because there was no compatibility there. But when Jesus calls us friends, you know what he's saying? He says, we got some common interests. We got some common goals. We have some things that now we share alike. And how does that happen? Does Jesus change what he did in order to fit us in our lifestyle? No, all the change comes from us right here. Do you realize Jesus Christ doesn't change? We're the ones that change. We're the ones that do something different. If you mention Jesus with your mouth, but there's no evidence in your life that you love him, that you serve him, that you desire him, that you do anything, it's an insult to his name. Because you're just taking his name in vain. Those that love him, yeah, they're going to obey him. And I'm telling you, that's something that God does in the heart. God does. Are you concerned with his will, with his desires? Are you inquiring about his truth and his revelation? Do you have a desire to serve him? Those are the ones that are really your friends. My point is don't misinterpret this phrase, friend of sinners, to think that you can just stay just like you are and Jesus is fine with it. He's not. He wants you to change. He wants you to surrender your. He wants you to turn from your sins. He wants you to realize that he's the only Lord, the only Savior. He's your only hope. You got to put all your eggs in his basket and his basket alone. That's his desire. You do that, he calls you his friend. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would bless your word, somehow use it to touch the hearts of those that have listened over the internet, those that are here in this room here today. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you don't leave us to ourselves, that you're with us all the time, that you help us. And Lord, your word is so amazing. Lord, help us to fall in love with it. Help us to fall in love with your will, with your desires, your goals. Lord, that we'd have perfect fellowship and harmony with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you. And I want you to know that if anybody's listening on the internet and they have any questions about anything that they preached, email us, call us, contact us on the website, however you can. We'd be happy to try to explain as much as we can to you. Praise the Lord.